which is true. And we need to assume that R is a PID. Every PID is a UFD.
You have to change, you have to control the change, ascending change.
So this is a slightly weaker R. Mm-hmm. You don't lose a lot. I mean, so if R, we need to assume that R is a PID for technical reasons. But actually, that comes in the proof explicitly. So every important power group of finite omega type happens to be omega local. It's what you want to happen, right? So again, so P groups are P local. That you can prove. What's the analog here? Finite omega type groups are omega local. So let me say something about omega maps, and we'll get to the good stuff in a moment. So suppose that we have a homomorphism of nipotent R power group. So these are R homomorphisms. R homomorphisms are like linear maps in a way. So it's like taking an R morphism of modules. So the thing I said very quickly at the beginning, I will say more slowly now. So we say that phi is omega injective if the kernel of phi is the omega prime torsion subgroup. So every element of the kernel is omega prime torsion. There is an alpha, which is an omega prime member, such that g to the alpha is 1 for every g. So these notions are, again, relative to omega. And it's going to be omega surjective if it's surjective up to exponentiation by omega prime members. So it's not that for every h in h, there's a, what am I saying here? Right, so it's not that every h is in the image of phi, but rather there is an omega prime member for which h to the alpha is in the image. So that's the notion of omega epimorphism, omega surjective. Okay. And omega isomorphism is what you would think. So let's get to the localization functor. So what is this? So we came up with this extension of the, let me give you this definition. It's really the classical definition extended to our context. And essentially what this is you start with nilpotent R power groups. So G and G omega is fixed. G and G omega are nilpotent R power groups, and you start with a homomorphism between them. So what do you say about it? Or what we want to define an omega localization map or omega universal map. So if you take any, well, first of all, if this one is omega local, and if you take any omega local nilpotent R power group in the world, you can find and a map of omega local groups, then there has to be a unique one that makes the diagram commute in this category. If that happens, then you say that E is omega, the omega localization map of omega universal map. Okay. So here's the fundamental theorem. And again, this is an extension of the theorem for classical nilpotent groups. And we had to assume that R is equal to D, as I explained before. And it's a nice theorem. It essentially says there is a localization functor in the category of nilpotent R power groups. There is one. And we were able to prove this following more or less the classical proof with some other things.
So it's due to you guys?
This is due to us, but I will say that this is a terribly difficult. I mean, it is due to us, and we have to think about certain bits and pieces of it. But the inspiration came from the classical theorem. So it was not a terribly difficult extension of the classical theorem. However, the rest of the stuff, we have to make some connections between residues. So we'll get to that.
So we
did prove this.
Well, the proof is,
oh, go ahead.
There are two views that, you know, in Warfield's book on nilpotent groups, he does it in a universal algebraic approach, which is what we took. Mm-hmm. In Reutberg's book with Hilton and who else?
Hilton Misling and
Misling.
Okay.
Right.
What they did in their book is they actually constructed this
Hilton Misling, right,
using tensor products and heavy duty algebra, which we couldn't do because that's specific to the abelian stuff.
And so there's a very functorial proof in the paper.
Yes.
On this, inspired Warfield.
Warfield guided us.
So if Warfield had not been around,
you would have figured
so
it out.
We thank Warfield.
Surely. This is where you need to prove, I guess, that you have that it's, you have this that universal object.
Yeah. Yes. Right, right.
It's well defined.
Yes, exactly. Okay, so so using isolator theory, one can show easily that omega localization is omega surjective. The more interesting bit will be to show that omega localization is omega injective. I will probably go through the details of that if you allow me, if you don't fall asleep. So so this is what Gabriel was talking about before. From now on, we need to assume that omega is finite. And so let me tell you about this theorem. Well, before I get into this, there is this result that says that if G is torsion free, okay, so let me tell you, just express it with words, no writing. So if G is torsion free in the R sense, then G is residually a finite pi type for every prime pi in R. This is an extension of a theorem by Grunberg in the classical Newport theory. Now we came up with a proof of this, which is a more general version of what I just said. And essentially what it says is, when is G residually finite omega type? Well, it's going to be residually finite omega type if and only if it is omega prime torsion free. So does everyone know what residually P means? Should I say anything about that? It should. Okay, so there are several definitions, equivalent definitions. If you take a group in this category, let's say G will be residual P, where P is a property of groups, if for every little g in capital G not equal to 1, there's a normal subgroup that doesn't contain it, such that G mod n has property P. Okay. And another equivalent definition is you can embed a residual P group can be embedded in a direct product of groups of that with that property.
Unrestricted.
Unrestricted. Yeah. So we're going to use that actually that fact in a moment. Unrestricted. Thank you. Okay. So let's see. That's kind of a nice theorem. So this E. So we developed all this technology. Why? Essentially to show that E is an omega isomorphism. So if you localize a finite set of primes, you get an omega isomorphism. So that's the theorem. And again, R is weaker. R is not a UFD. R is a PID, and it has to contain Q for technical reasons. But it turns out that this is a theorem. And so you have to assume that G is finitely generated. That's an important assumption. And so the omega localization map is always an omega isomorphism. So you want to see the sketch? Yes. So I will skip quite a few things. But all we need to show, really, is that the kernel has omega prime torsion elements. Now, if you remember why, it really is quite easy to show that E is omega epi. So to show that E is omega mono, we need to show that the kernel has omega prime torsion. So let's begin with the first bit. So suppose that G is in G, and it's a non-identity omega prime torsion element. We want to show that it's in the kernel. So you'll get to see some technology of omega local groups here. So alpha is an omega prime member. G to the alpha is 1. There has to be such alpha. And then you do a little calculation. So E of G to the alpha is 1. Now what does that mean? Well, what that means is that E of G itself is 1 because G omega is omega local. Make sense?
That calculation was the hardest part of the paper.
That was the hardest part. That was very, very struggle. We struggled with that calculation. So the omega prime torsion elements lie in the kernel. So now the other piece is, I'll tell you what the key step in the proof is, and it's coming up. So we show that that is 1-to-1, and that's really okay. Well, what is tau omega prime of G? That's the omega prime torsion elements of G. That turns out to be a normal R subgroup. So you have to check all these things. It works, and it suffices to show that this is 1-to-1. Why is that? Well, if we show that this is one to one, then what happens? Let's see. We need to take. So we need to show that the kernel lies in the omega prime torsion subgroup, right? So how do we show that the kernel lies in the omega prime torsion subgroup? If that's one to one, then if you take something in the kernel, you can use e hat and push it through, and then that something in the kernel will have to be in tau omega prime, right? So I have convinced you, hopefully, that all we need to show is that that thing is one to one. Did I convince you?
Yes.
Very nice. It's not bad. So watch. So G mod tau omega prime is omega prime torsion free. Therefore, is residually a finite omega type. Now that's the P. So it's really a sketch. I was careful enough to say sketch. I mean, there's more to this. But, so what that means is it can be embedded in an unrestricted direct product of the impotent power groups, and each one is of finite omega type. Turns out that any direct product like this will be of finite omega type as well, and therefore omega local. So anything of finite omega type is omega local, remember? So G mod tau omega prime is embeddable in an omega local group. Now, using the universal mapping property, you can show that it's actually embeddable in the omega localization. Omega localization is the best approximation to the group in this universe of omega local groups. So you can actually show that G mod tau omega prime is R embedded, or can be R embedded in G omega. And that takes care of it, then it's one to one. And everything is relative to R. So it turns out to be one to one. Okay. So that was the little proof. So more about this. A very easy corollary is this. G omega is an R embedding if and only if G is omega prime torsion free. Why is that? That's because E is an omega isomorphism. We know that at this moment. So because G is an omega isomorphism, then what's the kernel of E? It's the omega prime torsion elements. And so if G is omega prime torsion free, then you can actually embed G in its localization, which is a nice thing to know. When can you embed G in its localization, its omega localization? Okay. Interesting things that are not difficult, but we came across them and we thought they were interesting anyway. So the first thing is, take R star to be the ring of fractions of R. So we were sitting around and saying, well, what if you do that? So take R star to be the ring of fractions. You can do that, right? Okay, so you do that, and then you say, let's talk about rings now. So we're talking about groups, now let's talk about rings. So what's R omega? R omega is like this localization of Z, in a way. So it's all the alpha over beta, such that beta is an omega prime member. And we were playing around with our omega, and it turns out that we have a nice, easy, really easy proposition. So when is G omega local? Well, if and only if our omega acts on G. That's really, it's not a big deal, but it's a proposition. And since we have an action of our omega on G, we didn't know what to make of it. We said, well, maybe we get a nilpotent R omega powered structure on G. But we didn't even know whether R omega was binomial. And then we encountered that was a non-trivial question. And it turns out that, before I go for the research, Jesse Elliott proved this in one of his ring theorists. He proved that R omega is actually a binomial ring. So, okay, so questions for further research. So the first question, so all the rings will be UFDs. So let's look at the first problem here. Suppose you have a homomorphism between potent R powered groups, and this is a theorem in the class.